The topic for today's lecture of Database Management Systems is Structured Query Language. The agenda for today is, we will be quickly revisiting some relational models, SQL Query Language, Data Definition Language, which is a part of SQL, Basic Query Structure, Additional Basic Operations, some Set Operations, the Aggregate Functions in SQL. We will be summarizing and then finally we will go through certain assignments. So database, as we know, is a collection of multiple relations. For example, information about an enterprise, such as the details about instructor in university, the departments, it can all be collectively stored in the form of relations in a database. So we can have separate tables for instructor, student and department. A relational schema, which we represent by capital R, is a collection of attributes like A1, A2, AN. So there are n number of attributes in a relation capital R. So R is equal to A1, A2 till AN within small brackets is a relational schema. For example, instructor here is a relational schema which stores the details about the instructor. The details can be the ID of the instructor, the name of the instructor, the department name to which the instructor belongs, and the salary of that instructor. So ID, name, department name and salary are the four attributes of the relation instructor. Now, this relation, as you can see, is the table for instructor. These are the four attributes: ID, name, department name and salary. And the rows in this table, these rows are called tuples and the columns are called attributes. So since there are four attributes in this instructor relation, we have four columns, 1, 2, 3 and 4. And these are the tuples, all these rows are the tuples. And these rows represent the detail of different instructor in the organization. First tuple shows some detail about an instructor whose name is Srinivasan, whose ID is 10101, belongs to computer science department and the salary is 65,000. Here, in a relation, the order of the tuple is irrelevant. So, the order may vary. It does not matter in which order we insert the tuples. Coming to relational query languages, as we know, the languages may be procedural or non-procedural. The pure languages we have already learned are relational algebra, tuple relational calculus, domain relational calculus. Today we will be studying about structured query language, SQL. SQL is a standard that specifies a relational schema, how a relational schema is created. So in SQL we learn how a relational schema is created, how the data is inserted or updated in the relations. After creating the tables, we store the data into the tables. So we insert new data. We might also update the data after we have added ones. We need to change the values or we need to delete the tuples. So the data can be inserted and also it can be updated later on. We can also query from the databases. So, if we perform a query, we will extract or retrieve the data from the database. Transactions are started and stopped, and the programs access data in the relation. So, these are the things that an SQL, the SQL specifies. IBM SQL was developed as part of System R project at the IBM Sandoz Research Lab, which was later renamed as SQL. The ANSI and ISO standard SQLs are SQL 86, 89, 92, SQL 1999, 2003, 2008, and commercial system software often most follow the SQL 92 features. Coming to the components of SQL standards, these are the various components of SQL. First one is data definition language. Before we store the data into the database, we'll have to define the data. We have to create the structure of the data. So it is done by views and schema modification. So with the help of relation, we'll have to insert the data into the table. So we can insert the data using data manipulation language. We can update the data, which means we can modify the values of the data. We can delete the data. We can query the data in the tables. So data manipulation language specifies constructs for inserting, updating, querying the data in the tables. We also have embedded SQL and dynamic SQL. In order to retrieve data, query the data, we need to insert certain SQL commands into our programs which are written in high-level languages. So embedded SQL specifies how these SQL commands can be embedded in a high-level language such as C, C++ or Java. We also have transaction control in SQL, which specifies how the transactions are started and stopped and how a set of concurrently executing transactions can be managed. Authorization specifies how to restrict a user or maybe a set of users to access only certain parts of data and perform only certain types of queries. Since all the data which is stored in a database may not be of relevance to all the users, we restrict the users from performing certain tasks or accessing all the portion of the data. So we need to specify or restrict users from accessing all the parts of the data. Data definition language. DDL allows the specification of information about relations, including the schema for each relation, in which we specify the name of the table and the attributes, and then the domain of values which are associated with each attribute, and also the integrity constraints. Here are some domain types in SQL 92. Numeric data types. It may be integers, which are of various sizes, ints, small int. It may be real numbers of various precisions, real, float, double precision. It may be formatted numbers, decimal or numeric. Decimal ij represents that the attribute can take a decimal value having the total number of digits I. So the total number of digits in that value can be I, and the number of digits after decimal point is specified as j. So an attribute can have decimal value where I comma j represents that I is the total number of digits that an attribute can hold and j is the number of digits after the decimal point. Then we have character string data types. It may be of fixed length, character n. Here n is the number of characters that an attribute can hold. We also have varying length character strings. Varchar n. Here in this data type, n is the maximum number of characters that the attribute can hold. So we have two character string data types, char and varchar. In the case of char, the value of n is fixed, and here n gives the maximum number of characters. Then we also have day data type, which has 10 positions and the format is yyyy-mm-dt. So year, month and the date. We can also store time in time data type, which has 8 positions, sh, then month, then seconds. So hour, month and seconds. And we also have many more data types. Coming to constructing the table. We have create table command in order to construct a new table. We write create table and then give the name of the table. So here create table instructor will create a table with the name instructor. So create table instructor, and within these brackets, bracket starts, bracket begins, and within these brackets we give the list of attributes that this table will consist of. So ID is the first attribute and the type is character type, and the length of this is 5. So the first attribute of instructor is ID, which is of character type and can hold 5 characters. Another attribute is name, which is varchar type and it can hold maximum of 20 characters. Third attribute is department name, varchar type, length is 20. The salary of the instructor is numeric type and the maximum digits it can hold is 8, and then 2 digits after decimal point. So this is how we have created a table called instructor. Now see what happens when we insert a new tuple into this table instructor. Using insert into instructor values 1101, comma RAM, comma CSC, comma 66000, it will insert a new table, a new tuple into the table, where the ID is 1101, the name is RAM, the department name is CSC, and the salary of the instructor is 66000. Let us try to insert another tuple with the values 1101, a null for name, insert CSC department and 63000. So here we have inserted another tuple where the ID of instructor is again 1101, the name of the instructor is null, the department name is again CSC, and the salary is again 66000. Now we can very clearly observe that ID, as we know, for any instructor should be unique, and that's why it should not contain duplicate values. But here the ID for both the instructors are same. We can also see that name for the first instructor is Ram and for another instructor is taken as null. But an instructor will surely have some name. Name cannot have null value, but it has taken, accepted the value null as the value for name. Now we'll need to impose certain restrictions on the table for such events. These are integrity constraints in create table. Let's see, it is, the first one is not null. Not null constraint prevents null values entering into the columns. So if we want that name should not be null, we should impose this this integrity constraint not null on this column, which will prevent us from entering null into the main column. Another integrity constraint is primary key. Primary key uniquely identifies each row of the table and it prevents null value. When we say uniquely identifying, it means that it will hold a unique value for each instructor in our case. So, if we say that ID is the primary key, we declare it as primary key, then ID will hold unique values and also it will not allow any null values in the ID column. Another integrity constraint is unique. Unique column will not allow duplicate values to be present in it. But unlike primary key, it will allow null values. Another constraint is foreign key. So we write foreign key AM to AN, references R. This specifies that an attribute A1 of the table being defined, say R1, is a foreign key which is referring to an attribute B1 of table R2. It means that when there are two tables R1 and R2 and A1 is the foreign key of R1 and B1 is the primary key of R2, then each value of the column A1 is either null or is one of the values that appear in column B1 of R2. Let us see. When we apply all these constraints on create table instructor, we can write it again as create table instructor, ID character 5, name varchar 20, not null. Here when we specify not null, it will not allow nulls. Then department name varchar 20, salary 8,2, and primary key ID. Here we have declared ID as the primary key. So it will not allow duplicate values and null values. Here we declare department name as the foreign key. Foreign key department name. So here this department name is being declared as the foreign key for the table instructor. Foreign key table name references department, where department is some other relation. We can also define it in another way, say create table student. This is another example for a table student, where we say that ID of a student is varchar 5, primary key. We can also declare primary key in this way. Name which is not null, department name, total credits, and the foreign key department name, this department name becomes the foreign key, and references department. So these are the two ways we can declare primary key. We can either write it this way or we can write it this way. So here, as you can see, after creating this table, we have created a table with ID, name of the instructor, department name, and the salary. Where ID, as we have declared a primary key, does not hold any duplicate values and also there are no null values. In the same way, name does not hold any null values. Referential integrity constraint. Now, let F be a foreign key in schema R1. Which is referring to schema R2, and let K be the primary key of the relation R2. So there are two relation schemas, R1 and R2. and F is the foreign key of R1 and K is the primary key of R2. Now, in a referential integrity constraints, any relation in sense R1 on relation schema R1 and R2 on relation schema R2 must be such that for any tuple P in R1, either its F attribute values are null or they are identical to the K attribute value of some tuple in R2. So RIC ensures that references to tuples in R2 are for currently existing tuples. Let us understand this by an example. Here we have two tables. One is course and another is department. Course ID, name, credits and department number are four attributes of course. Department ID, name, HOD and phone are the four attributes of department. In the course table, department number is the foreign key, and in the department table, department ID is the primary key. So, according to referential integrity constraints, the foreign key of course table can hold either null or only the values which exist in the primary key of department table. So here we can see that the department number here is 1 which exists in department table. Again it is 1 which exists in department table. Department number is 2 which exists in the primary key column of the department table. And here 3 also exists in the department table. So here the foreign key attribute department number of course refers to the primary key of the department ID, that is the primary key of the department relation. If in case a new tuple enters with the course ID C751, name is mass transfer, credits are 3 and department number is 4. In such a case, referential integrity constraint is violated because the value in the foreign key, that is department number of course table, is 4, which does not exist in the primary key of the department, that is department ID. So we have 1 here, we have 2, we have 3, but we do not have 4. Therefore, this is a violation of referential integrity constraint. Now, what to do if such RIC violation occurs? So, RIC violation can occur if a reference tuple is deleted or modified. And the action can be specified for each case using the qualifiers onDelete or onUpdate. Now, let us see, when does the RIC violation occur? In case I delete this tuple from the department table, so this tuple number 4 contains 3. In such cases, things, that is on delete and on update, so RIC violation can occur on deleting. Here, in this case, foreign key attribute value, update this 3 to 5, the value 3 is of cascade. If I delete this tuple will also be deleted. If I update this value will also be updated. Back to the table definition example. Create table students. Roll number character 8. Attribute is department ID. So here we are using on delete here will also be updated. So this is how we write the drop table student will delete the table and also its contents. So if you want to delete the contents of the table as well as the table, we use drop table, then the table name. Delete from student, it will delete the contents of the table student, but it will retain the table. In this case, only the content will be deleted and table is not deleted. In case of drop table, both the contents and the table is deleted. Alter table construct. After we have created a table, we may require to add few more attributes or modify few more attributes or delete few attributes. If you want to add a new attribute into the table, we write alter table, then give the table name alter table R, add capital A is for attribute, the new attribute that we wish to add, and then capital D is the domain. So if I say alter table student, add branch character 10, it will add a new column branch in the table student. Similarly, alter table R drop A. So this command will drop the attribute from the relation R. Let's now learn about the basic query structure. So a typical SQL query looks like this. Select the list of attributes, select A1, A2 to AN from the relations, the tables R1, R2 till Rm, where capital P is the condition. So A represents the attribute, R represents the relation or the tables, and P is some condition. It is to be noted that the result of any SQL query is also a relation. Let's learn about the select clause. The select clause lists the attributes that are desired in the results of a query. As we saw, select A1, A2 till AN. So here, this select query will list all the attributes that are specified here. For example, if you want to find the name of all instructors, we say select name from instructor. Instructor is the table which holds ID of the instructor, name of the instructor, department and the salary, out of which we only want to find out the names of all the instructors. So we have selected only the name attribute. Now here the SQL names are case insensitive. So you may write it like this or this way. If you want to select more than one attribute, we could have written select name, salary from instructor. So the result would hold only name and the salary column values from instructor name. Here the output will be only the names from the instructor name. Allows duplicates in relations as well as in query relations. So in this case, as you can see, if there are any duplicate values, it will be selected. So in order to avoid these duplicate values, we use the keyword distinct after select. So if we write select distinct department name from instructor, it will choose only distinct department names and it will eliminate the duplicate ones. Here in this case, if we see computer science, appears 3 times, finance appears 1 and 2 times, physics appears 1 time and 2 times, and so on. So if we say select distinct department name from instructor, it will duplicate, eliminate all duplicates, and all the department name will appear only once. If we require all the values to appear, the keyword all specifies that duplicates are not to be removed. So we can write select all department name from instructor. In this case, duplicates will not be removed. If we wish to select all the attributes of the table, instead of writing all the attributes, we can simply write a star. So this asterisk denotes all attributes. So if we say select star from instructor, it will select all the attributes from the table instructor. The select clause can also contain arithmetic expressions involving plus, minus, asterisk for multiplication and division. If you say select ID, comma name, comma salary divided by 12 from instructor, there will be 3 attributes selected as a result. One is ID, one is the name of the instructor, and then the salary divided by 12. The third column will hold the value of salary, which will be divided by 12. Coming to the where clause, which specifies the predicate, the condition. It specifies the condition that the result must satisfy, and comparison results can be combined using the logical connectives and, or, and not. To find all instructors in computer science department with salary greater than 80,000. So there are 2 conditions: that the department name should be computer science and the salary should be greater than 80,000. We write select name from instructor where department name is equal to computer science and salary is greater than 80,000. This query will give us the names of all the instructors who belong to department computer science and draw a salary greater than 80,000. Here we have used the connective AND. If we see the department is computer science, the department is computer science here, but the salary is not greater than 80,000. In this case, department is computer science, but the salary is not greater than 80,000. In this tuple, the department is computer science and the salary is more than 80,000. So, only this tuple satisfies both the conditions, and hence the name is retrieved. So, the output for this query will give the name Brad. The from clause. From clause gives the list of relations which are involved in the query. Let us try to perform a Cartesian product. Select star from instructor and comma teachers. Here, 2 relations are involved, instructor and teachers. It will generate every possible instructor-teacher pair with all attributes from both the relations. Since we have given select star, it will select all the attributes from both these relations, and hence it will perform a Cartesian product between instructor and teacher. Let us see how it happens. Let this table be instructor and this is teachers. Now, since we have written star, it will give us all the attributes present in both these fields. So here we have ID, name, department number and salary. Here also we have an ID, course ID, section ID, semester and year. So we have all the attributes, 4 attributes from here and 5 attributes from here. So we have instructor.id. Since both the tables contain the attributes with the same name, in order to differentiate, we name it as INSC.id for instructor and here teachers.id for teachers ID. So we have instructor.id, name, department name, salary, teachers.id, course ID, section ID, semester and year. Now, as we know that this query will generate every possible instructor-teacher pair, let's try to see how it happened. Let's take the first tuple from instructor table and combine it with all the tuples of teachers. So 101 Srinivasan, computer science, 65,000, 101, CS101, section ID 1, semester is fall, year is 2009. So this is how the first tuple of this Cartesian product is formed. 10101 Srinivasan, computer science, 65,000. 10101, this is the second tuple, CS315, 1, spring and 2010 forms the second tuple for this table. And so on. We get the product for each tuple with all the tuples of teacher's table. Again, for the second tuple, we combine this with all this to get these tuples, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, and so on. This is the Cartesian product of instructor with teachers. For all instructors who have taught some course, find their names and the course ID of the courses they taught. To solve this query, we'll have to perform join. Now, let us see. We have to select the name and course ID. The name is given, the name of an instructor is given in instructor table and the course ID. Course ID appears in teacher's table. So, in order to get both the name and course ID, we need to have the Cartesian product of instructor with teachers, and then when we get this product, we look at this condition. The instructor ID should be equal to teacher's ID. When instructor ID is equal to the teacher's ID, let us take the first tuple. Instructor ID 10101 here is equal to the teachers.id. So first tuple satisfies the condition. The second tuple, let us see, instructor.id is equal to teachers.id. And third tuple also, instructor.id is equal to teachers.id. In fourth tuple, it is not equal, so it will not be selected. In the same way, the result for this query comes out to be this, where instructor ID is same as teacher's ID for these three tuples. Here for this tuple also, instructor.id is equal to teachers.id. So, retrieving name and course ID for all these four tuples, we get name Srinivasan. And course ID is CS101. Name Srinivasan for the other tuple and and the fourth side is CS315. So these are the four tuples we get as the result of this query. So we have selected name and course ID from instructor and teachers, where instructor.id is equal to teachers.id. So when we simply say select star from instructor comma teachers, we perform the Cartesian product and then we add this condition to it, we get the join. Ordering the display of the tuples. Sometimes we need to display the values in some specific order. It may be ascending or descending. Let us take this query. Select distinct name from instructor, order by name. So all distinct names from the table instructor will be listed and those names will be displayed in the ascending order of names. By default, if it is not mentioned here, it is taken to be ascending. If we wish to display these names in descending order, we can simply say order by name descending. We write DESC for descending. So we can say select distinct name from instructor, order by name descending. So it will output all the names of instructors in the descending order. Let us learn some set operations. Union, intersect and except are the three set operations which automatically eliminates the duplicate values. In these set operations, operands need to be union compatible and also have same attributes in the same order. Let us see. If we want to find the courses that ran in fall 2009 or in spring 2010, we'll have two list of courses. One that was offered in fall 2009, which means the semester was fall and the year was 2009. And we'll also find out a list for all those courses which were offered in spring and the year was 2010. And then we'll combine both these lists. So to get the courses which were offered in fall 2009, we write the query, select course ID from section where semester is equal to fall and year is equal to 2009. And we perform a union of this query with another query which will select the course ID from section where semester is equal to spring and year is equal to 2009. So output of these two queries will be combined. We will get a union of the two results. We go through this data. The first query will give us all the tuples where semester is fall and year is 2009. So first tuple here satisfies the first query. Third tuple also satisfies the first query. We have another sixth tuple satisfying the first query. So out of first query we can get the result first tuple, third tuple and the sixth tuple. The tuple satisfying the second query, that is spring 2010, we have second tuple, fourth, fifth, seventh, 8 and 9. So as a combination we can see, since we are interested in only the course ID, CS101, CS347 and Physics101 will be the result for the first query. So for this query, we get the result course ID as CS101, CS347 and Physics101. It shows that these were the three courses which were offered in fall 2009. We take this query as capital A and this query as capital B. So capital A union B is shown here. The result of A is this. The result of B for spring 2010 is this. A union B will give us all these values plus the values from. And now see the duplicate values have been eliminated. CS101 is appearing only once. If we say A intersect B, this means that only the common values will be output. So here the only common value is CS101. So A intersect B gives C101. Another is A except B. This means that the values that exist in A but does not exist in B. Let us say CS101. It appears in A but it also appears in B. So it will not be considered. CS347. It appears in A but it does not appear in B. So CS347 is appearing in A except B. Physics101 appears in A but it doesn't appear in B. So we have Physics101. So these are the only two courses that appear in A but does not appear in B. We have some aggregate functions. These functions operate on a set of values of a column or a relation and then return a value. Average value is given by ABG. Min gives the minimum value. Max gives the maximum value. Sum gives the sum of those values and count gives the total number of values in that particular column. Let us find the average salary of instructors in the computer science department. So, for all the instructors that belong to computer science department, we'll get the average of the salary. So, all the salaries of the instructors belonging to computer science department will be used to compute the average. If we wish to find the total number of instructors who teach a course in spring 2010 semester, so we want to get total number, we use count. Select count distinct ID, total number of instructors. So distinct ID will remove the duplicate ones. Select count distinct ID from teachers where semester is equal to spring and year is equal to 2010. Find the number of tuples in the course relation. So we want the total number of tuples in course. So we simply write select count star from course. Count star will give you the total number of tuples in a relation. Group by class. Find the average salary of instructors in each department. So now we want that what is the average salary which is given in each department. So we will select department name and the average salary from instructor, group by department name. In the absence of group by department name, we will get the average salary of all the instructors. But here, since we have given group by department name, it will group all the tuples belonging to similar departments and for each department it will compute the average salary separately. So, let's take this example. Select department name and average salary from instructor table and group by department name. Here, To get the result for this query, let us group the department. Group the tuples by department. So biology, there is only one tuple. So it is 72,000. So in the result, we have the average salary as 72,000. Computer science had three tuples. It means that there were three instructors who belong to computer science department. So all these three instructors' salary is taken into consideration and the average is computed as 77,333. Electrical engineering department, there was only one instructor, so the average salary is 80,000. There were two instructors belonging to finance department and the average salary is 85,000. History also had two instructors and the average salary is 61,000. Music had only one instructor, the average salary is 40,000. For physics, there were two instructors and the average salary comes out to be 91,000. So since we have given group by department name, based on the department name, all these tuples were grouped together and for each group, the average salary was computed. One thing should be noted very carefully, that the attributes in the select clause that you give here outside of the aggregate function must appear in the group by list. Here, aggregate function is average of salary. Apart from this function, there are two attributes, department name and ID. In group by, we have written only department name and ID doesn't appear here. So this is an erroneous query. So all those attributes that appear here apart from the aggregate function should also appear in group by. So we should not have written ID here. So today we revisited the relational model where we studied that database is a collection of tuples, relational schema consists of a number of attributes, where attributes are represented by columns and the rows are called tuples. Then we learned some basic SQL query. The components are data definition language, data manipulation language, embedded SQL, authorization and transaction. In data definition language, we learned how to create the relational schema, how to update the schema or alter the schema, how to drop the table, and then we learned some of the basic SQL structures, the select clause, from clause, where clause. We also learned certain Cartesian product and joins and other basic operations, group by, and some set operations like union, intersect and except. We also learned aggregate functions like average, minimum, maximum, sum and count. Let's apply all this that we have learned in this session to this database. This is an exercise for you to do it yourself. Let's create a database consisting of these two tables, employee, which has these five columns, employee number, numeric type, name is welfare type, job is character type, salary is again numeric, department number is also numeric. You can choose the length of your choice. Create another table for department with department number, department name and locate the department as the three attributes. And practice some of these SQL queries using these tables we have created. List the name of analysts and salesmen. List the name of employees whose employee numbers are these out of these five. List the different designations in the company. List the number of employees working with the company. List the number of designations that are available with EMP table. And finally, list the total, maximum, minimum and the average salary offered in the company. These are the six queries that you can perform on these two tables. Read every query very carefully so that you can select the suitable operations to get the desired results correctly. These are the books that have been referred for this session. You may use these books, you may refer them to perform these SQL queries. Thank you.